This time of year seems to bring out the ghosts and goblins. Coming up next, we'll hear of some real-life hauntings that don't go away after Halloween.
Thank you. Well, Halloween is the time of the year when children and adults alike dress up in strange costumes and pretend they're someone or something that they're not. Ghosts and goblins are on the children's minds. Certainly, many myths have sprung up around this particular day, and certain mystic feelings are there. Here to talk about Halloween and what it really means, where it came from, and indeed, ghosts in general, is a gentleman who has done a great deal of research in this field. He is a parapsychologist. Welcome Dr. Hans Holzer to Kelly and Company. Hans, Halloween means what? All Hallows' Eve?
Correct. It's really the pagan equivalent of All Souls' Day, which follows November 1. There's really no difference except that the pagans were there ahead of Christianity, and they celebrated the changing of the seasons from the summer to the winter half of the year. And in the old pagan Anglo-Saxon Celtic religion called the Old Religion, which we know as witchcraft, white witchcraft, that is, simply the celebration consisted in, at midnight, opening the gates to the other side of the world so that the spirits of the dead could converse with the living. And that is how ghosts got into the act, really, basically. The idea that the spirits can, in fact, talk to the living at that particular time. But Halloween, which we celebrate with dressing up and with candy and with,
trick-or-treating.
Trick-or-treating, all this. That is a development in relatively modern times, aided and abetted by, I would think, the toy and candy manufacturers.
I think so.
Which bears very little resemblance to what it's all about.
What is it all about, then?
It's a serious holiday in the pagan calendar, marking the beginning of winter and also the changing of the seasons and a kind of thinking about death and transfiguration and all those things.
It's because of the death of the leaves, I suspect.
Yeah, it's a seasonal holiday and nothing more than that. You have all kinds of weird notions, of course, unless you happen to know. And I've spent a lot of time doing a documentary, which still, after 10 years, isn't finished, on the witchcraft movement, on the neo-pagan movements, good, bad, and indifferent. And
all right, let's talk about witchcraft for a minute. We know the popular conception, we all do, the witch riding the broom and the cone cap and all that stuff.
And the black cat, don't forget.
Yes,
that.
Black cat. Yes. And you mentioned there's two kinds of witchcraft?
There's only one kind, because there's no such thing as black witchcraft. That's another. Black witchcraft and warlocks are strictly Hollywood. I miss them too, personally.
Yeah.
But basically, witchcraft is Wiccacraft, which is the old religion of England and Scandinavia.
Yeah.
Wicca. There is a tiny and very vociferous movement, if that's what you call it, called Satanism, which has nothing to do with witchcraft. It's a perversion of witchcraft. To witchcraft, Satanism is what atheism is to Christianity. It's the perversion. It's the taking the trimmings and using them for their own purpose. And satanic groups exist. There are the real ones you and I will never meet because they're killers, they're murderers, and they're insane, like the Mansons. And then there's the would-be satanic group, mainly very young people who get the thrill of dressing up in black robes and inverted pentagrams.
We've heard playing
all,
records backwards.
It's all B-U-L-L.
Balderdash.
Yes, that's the word you're looking for. You pronounce it a little differently from me, but I'm from New York, so we cleaned that up. There is nothing to that except in the mind of the one who practices.
Do you mean
it.
That witches cannot cast evil spells?
They can't even turn you and I into frogs. Now, personally, I don't want to be a frog.
But
witchcraft, above all, is a form of self-fulfillment. Through four books and a documentary and countless television work, I have found that the main thing about witchcraft, and it's a very sincere belief, is that God is a woman, the mother goddess. They believe in the deity being female, which is all to the good, frankly, because you and I know that women are much smarter than men, and I don't care what anybody says.
Certainly boss here. Wait a minute. He's just trying to curry favor with this audience.
Never mind. It's not that they have done anything. That's the way nature arranged it.
See? Women are smarter.
Right.
They must be. They live longer, and we work harder, and we die sooner.
Yes, and we have more fun, but on the other hand. Yeah. But, you know, so it all balances in nature. But basically, what I'm saying is that the old religion of England and Scandinavia, yes, believes God is a lady, believes in reincarnation, believes also in the environment, into ecology, all the things that are essentially very positive. They do not know a thing about the devil. That is the invention of the medieval church.
Well, then all of this really sprang from a harvest, successful or not, preparation for
right.
the winter, celebration of the fact that it was
yes.
a good harvest and a good year,
yes.
and the death of a season and
yes.
the beginning of
yes.
another.
Yeah, so, I mean, they're all very nice people in the yeah. old days. I mean, they had little sex in the fields,
yeah.
Which may be inconvenient, but it's apparently worked for the fields.
Certainly
know?
Dirty.
Yeah, well... But
dusty, anyway.
Yeah, well, you know, there's all kinds of chances you take.
A lot of straw sticking out of the ears, I
yes.
guess.
Yes, well, not only out of the ears, but all
Never
kinds
mind.
Of possibilities, yes. But they did it, you know, they were having their thing, and,
yeah.
You know, they were sort of rolling with it. But today, you know... well, you know, enjoying.
Mm.
Today, they don't do that anymore. You see, they have now their celebrations are more
what
symbolic.
Do you mean they don't do that anymore? You certainly
not
are from
fields.
New York, Doctor.
Well, you know.
Okay.
The fields.
They do here in Michigan, boy. Hooray, hooray, it's the 1st of May. Remember that one? Guess what? Starts today. Well, and I guess there are no such things as ghosts and all that either.
Oh, yes, there are ghosts. Heavens, yes. I mean, that's the wrong word, perhaps, but there are ghosts. Well,
apparitions?
Apparitions. Well, I have spent, I don't know how many years in parapsychology, and of course they are ghosts. And, in fact, there's photographic evidence of apparitions. They are people. They are not devils, and they are not monsters. I mean, Ghostbusters aside, you know, there are parts of people when somebody passes on in shock and isn't aware of this transition called physical death,
yeah, well,
then
look,
something
look,
happens. Now, this one, for instance.
Is that a ghost?
That's, as a matter of fact, three ghosts is taken on the test condition by a doctor, a medical doctor, Dr. Hans Holzer, on a golf course in California. And this is happens to be three monks.
Playing through.
Walking, playing through. And they happen to be enveloped by flames because in 1532, and that's a long story I won't go into, they were burned for being heretics by fellow monks. Those were charming times.
Yeah. Let's see that again, please.
Yeah.
Have you lost
I'm going to walk the other way.
There they
probably.
Are. There
yeah.
they are.
No, here they
now,
are.
These guys were burnt. Was this the location where there's now a golf course? Where they?
Yes, yes.
I see.
And the interesting part about it is the Historical Society insisted there had never been any monks there. And I was originally an historian, a trained historian, and I don't take anybody's word for anything anymore. So I went to the museum in New York, the Hispanic Society, and there found an original broadside, which is a document printed at the time, and there was a story about a group of Franciscan monks having gone off into the wilderness of Northern California and written to the Spanish crown complaining about mistreatment of the Indians. And the Spanish crown, instead of doing something about it, sent them the Dominicans, which were the Inquisition, had them burned. And
yeah.
this is a fact. And they're apparently still walking. It's a long walk.
And you can take... What is this?
Well, this is... The white thing on the right is taken in a house in Ireland. You can see it, you know, just barely in this one, but it's a white shadow of a woman servant who wasn't told she was dead, and she kept on serving the master day in, day out, walking through the walls.
She wasn't told she was dead?
No, she hadn't been informed.
I think she could figure it out herself.
Well, yeah, I figured because she wasn't getting any wages anymore.
Right, no payday.
But she didn't look for them either, come to think of it.
Can these creatures reach out and do you harm?
First of all, they're not creatures, they're
not
people.
Creatures,
yeah, but
apparitions.
They're not aware of you and I, barely aware, because they are so caught up in these, these are thought forms. They are part of the personality that stays behind when the physical body is dissolved. And it is not... These people are unable to cope with what they are. I mean, they're in trouble.
But they don't necessarily come out and do their thing more than others on other days of the year on Halloween.
No, that's a fantasy,
yes,
of course.
Fantasy.
But they're there all the time, day in and night. They don't walk at midnight. They walk all hours of the day.
Not in the full moon or anything
no,
like
no,
that.
No, none of that. It's very romantic, and I love it. But the truth of the matter is, apparitions are very real. They are not supernatural. They're part of human experience.
I saw some hands. Now, you guys, it's all up to you. But just before we began this, a goodly number of you said you believed in ghosts. Do you, any of you, have an experience to which you can attribute this firm belief? And if so, may I see your hands? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, well, do you mind talking about it? Think about it. We'll take a break and be back with Dr. Holzer in 2 minutes and see if they want to talk about their ghostly experience. Thank you. Thank you. All right, we're back with Dr. Holzer, and this is one of the folks that says you've had a ghostly experience?
Similar, I think. When I was 14, my dad's mother died, and we were living in Missouri at the time, and they flew to Dundee, Michigan to her funeral, and they mailed a box of things that belonged to my grandmother home before they flew back. And when they got home that night, my mother had these little cards. I guess they're death cards, or little death certificates or whatever they are. And I asked her if I could have one, and she said to talk to her in the morning, and she would give me one then. She had to mail a bunch of them out. Well, I looked with her all that morning, and we could not find them, and I saw where she put them. Well, that day, we forgot about it, and that day, that same day, the UPS man came with that box that they had mailed home, and there those cards were on the very top of that box, and we opened it up.
Yeah, they like to do that, little things like that. It's when somebody passes on, they would like you to know that things aren't exactly the way they were supposed to be.
I didn't know what the message was, and if it would have just happened to my mother, I would have thought she was crazy. But it's just...
You experienced.
I was there with her, and I experienced it too, and we never did understand what the message was or what it meant.
Simple. The message is simple, to let you know that life goes on.
That's it.
Scary business.
Gentleman here has had an experience. Yes, sir, would you stand?
Yes, a couple years ago in Connecticut, in a house, and they said, this special chair is for the ghost. Don't sit in it. And I said, okay, and the house was built in 17-something, and they showed me through the house, and they had many different stories around the area of Connecticut, and they said, don't sit in that chair, and don't close that door. So, being a Michigander, I'm not from Missouri, but I have to be proven to myself.
I closed the door.
No, you sit in a chair. No, I didn't go that far.
Okay.
They showed me the rest of the house. It was about a 6-story house, and we went up and down. We come back to that door, and it was open. And the chair was actually swaying.
Well, if you would have sat into it, it would have been kind of a hot seat, wouldn't it? Yes.
Oh. I think so.
But these things do happen. There's a chair in Ashlawn, which is near Washington, that keeps swinging back and forth all the time. It used to be President Monroe's personal chair.
Hans, have you ever, in all of the years that you have, and we're making gags here, but the truth is that this is a very serious research project and ongoing for you.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever encountered a situation that you find totally inexplicable, that you cannot explain?
Well, I'm congenitally incapable of accepting anything as not explicable, because I think there's always an answer if you look for it. No, I've never been faced with a situation that I could not sooner or later find a reason for. But the reason includes, of course, a firm conviction there is an ongoing dimension to which we all go.
Have you ever been in fear?
In fear?
Right.
Only in fear of human ignorance and human stupidity, which occasionally crops up even among the best. But basically, no, because I enter this openly. I come as a friend to those on the other side of life. And a couple of times I have been in a kind of a tight spot when they get mad at me. But then you keep calm and you just remember that you must be in charge or else you lose everything.
Have you ever felt a malevolence, an evil?
Oh, yes, I have. In the Amityville house, it wasn't particularly pleasant. But I don't allow these things to prevail. Sure, the poor Indian chief in the Amityville house wasn't exactly a happy person.
Yes.
Having had his skull cut off from his skeleton, you know, it's not very pleasant, especially when you're still in it.
I'll drink to that. After this show, I may drink to anything. Yes, ma'am.
There's a rocking chair that rocks in my attic only when I'm home by myself, and I've gone up there to see. Don't rock when I get there, but as I leave and get downstairs, it starts to rock again.
You have a relative, probably. He doesn't want to be left alone.
Oh, okay. I'll see about that.
Has that rocking chair been in the family for a while?
I don't know. I can't. I just hear it.
You just hear it?
Yeah. And I go up to see. And when I get there, I can't hear anything. And I only hear it when I'm home by myself.
Have you ever seen the chair rocking?
Yeah.
Try to find out whether one of your passed on relatives is just kind of lonely, because I'm serious about this. People who pass on and don't want to continue passing on hang around and they like attention.
Okay.
Okay, I remember I was small, and I was just about 10 years old, and my brother had been acting up, so I said, well, I'm going to tell mother to get you. My parents is dead, both of them. And I went to her picture. She had a large picture with about 8 by 10. And I said, okay, mother, Ted's been acting up, so you should give him a whooping. And so that night, something whipped him. Because when he woke up, I mean, he had whips all over him. And he was screaming and hollering, but nobody was there. So what do you account that to?
I can match this kind of story all 1,000 times over. Just try to understand that when you pass on into the next stage of existence, you have all your foibles, your personality, your likes and dislikes, your weaknesses and your strength intact. You don't turn into something ethereal just because you're over there.
Yes, ma'am, would you stand, please?
My father died in the afternoon. My mother and I came home and found him. That night I slept on the sofa. Middle of the night, I sat up and my dad was standing there talking to me, telling me everything was going to be all right, don't worry. 2 seconds later, my mother flew out of the bedroom and told her, Dad said everything's going to be all right, you're going to take care of me.
Yes, why not? Of course, this is a very common thing, actually.
I couldn't see through him. I saw him. He was there.
Oh, that's another thing about ghosts being ethereal and sort of you can see through them and they float. All this is not true.
Well, why can't you take their picture then instead of seeing these things like
But I have, and others have.
Well, those are the two things you just showed us.
Well,
I mean, that could be overexposed film.
No, it cannot. Show it again, if you believe.
No, he's got them put away. You got any yellows left up there, Mason? I mean, it could be...
How can you say that?
It could be light struck. It could be fogged, as we say.
No, I have 50 photographs of apparitions taken under test conditions.
Now, there's the three
guys. You don't see the
figures? I mean, the film could have gone partially unrolled,
but
and the three monks
could
have got to be your thumb.
It didn't. That's the whole point. This was taken on a test condition by a medical doctor. Now, this doesn't look like overexposure. The figures, you can see that. The heads and arms and all that. And I can match this with dozens of others. Sure, of course. Some years ago...
Are you an imaginative or an unimaginative person? How would you categorize yourself?
Very unimaginative. I'm very cautious. I'm not from Missouri, but I feel that way. No.
It's got to be proven.
Well, it's got to be reasonably proven. But remember, the will to disbelieve is 10 times stronger than the will to believe, because it upsets us to think that there is another side to life when we die. A lot of people don't want to hear about that.
Doggone it, our time is gone. I'm so fascinated by this, and I wanted to get into reincarnation. Hans, you're in town. Aren't you appearing somewhere in the area?
I did last night.
He had one of the things that interests him is reincarnation, because he said you feel all these things are allied. And his current book is Life Beyond Life, The Evidence for Reincarnation. Putting it another way, previous lives and lives in the future. Fascinating, Hans. Always good to have you here. I hope that you'll be in our area again real soon. Let's pick it up where we left off.
And I hope your Halloween is a pleasant one and all your witches are friendly.
Dr. Hans Holzer. Right back.